Channel 5 News covers the inauguration of Harold Washington live Friday at 2.
That you cannot please all of the people, even some of the time, is not news. But it's always good for a headline.
So too, it seems, bizarre business dealings, coming out from under the bed to sing your song, or eating the mail. And that's the menu for another sitting of Overnight.
Usually the result of rhetoric is more rhetoric. On Wednesday, the president said what he wanted to say about Central America, and there were few surprises. On Thursday, others spoke, and surprises were even fewer. Except for a disturbing bit of candor on the part of the president, who, when asked why he waited until Thursday to nominate Richard Stone as his special Central American envoy, replied it was his feeling he ought to save some news for today. Here, then, our scheduled ration.
The president came in to add a little clout to the announcement. Richard Stone was grateful that he had been named after waiting for 2 days because of last-minute congressional criticism.
Could I begin by indulging in an old Latin custom with you? It's called an abrazo. Thank you so much.
The former senator from Florida is controversial. Although a Democrat, other Democrats say he is too conservative. And he did work for the right-wing government of Guatemala. Some question his ability to negotiate with the left, but the president has no doubts.
I think that it just adds to the experience that he's had down there, and I know the job that he can do.
It's not a question of trusting me. It's a question of trusting the Latin nations themselves. They are going to set this agenda, and we will do our best to support that agenda.
But he warned, no easy solutions.
The odds are long. It's a very difficult situation. Anyone who thinks that a mere invitation to peace will produce peace is just inaccurate and unrealistic.
Stone said he'll carry out the principles the president outlined Wednesday night. But those principles did not reassure members of the House Intelligence Committee. Although they put off a vote until next week, they said they do plan to cut off money for Mr. Reagan's not-so-secret secret war in Nicaragua.
Well, my own judgment is that there were sufficient votes on our side to pass the bill out.
And despite the president's speech, other House members still don't trust his policies.
I fear that the lessons of the Vietnam War have been lost upon this president.
The rhetoric was hauntingly similar to the rhetoric that we heard preceding the Vietnam buildup.
One of Richard Stone's jobs will be to work with Congress and build confidence in the president's policies. But some senators who work with Stone think he's too right-wing. Others say he's not bright. Many just don't like him. The opposition isn't deep enough to block his confirmation, but the proposed ambassador doesn't have enough friends on Capitol Hill to help Mr. Reagan very much. Andrea Mitchell, NBC News at the White House.
As the White House was announcing the Stone appointment, the Salvadoran leadership was expressing its gratitude for the president's stand on Central America. But these men are less than enthusiastic about Mr. Reagan's choice of a special ambassador. The Salvadoran president did not exactly give Stone a ringing endorsement.
To appoint an officer of the higher level, very close and with direct line to the White House, I think is very important to help to solve the problem of Central America.
Privately, many of these men were hoping that Mr. Reagan would choose a career diplomat to work on solving the tricky problems of Central America. In this capital, the former Florida senator is widely regarded as ill-equipped for the role. As they were reading about President Reagan's speech to Congress last night, many Salvadorans were wondering how deeply the new special ambassador will get involved in Salvadoran internal affairs. Many groups, including the Chamber of Commerce here, were warning about the danger of too much Yankee meddling.
One of the special ambassador's main jobs will be to get the Salvadoran guerrillas to participate in upcoming presidential elections. The guerrillas have called the elections a farce. So, for a lot of reasons, it does not look like Richard Stone will have an easy time here. George Lewis, NBC News, San Salvador.
It was the day taped is something of an equal time event. Ronald Reagan had his chance the night before, so the Sandinistas would use this rally as their show of force. Small groups began gathering hours before the rally was to begin. It was a coordinated event, timed perfectly to use President Reagan's speech as an inspiration for national unity, and perhaps to take advantage of the international focus he immediately thrust on them. Clearly, they see him as their worst enemy. That's bad for them.
Luchamos para vencer.
But on the other hand, he's given them a good chance to try to show the world they are only simple working people united to save their country. It is with public rallies like this and other quieter ways they eventually hope to turn the international eye more favorably in their direction. Mauri Moore, NBC News, Managua.
Workers rising to the defense of their nation makes sense on the surface, and similar to the explanation put forth by other workers rising to the defense of another country, ours. The problem in this case, the workers are on a considerably higher level, and they are also investors, which also makes sense, but not enough to stop some from wanting to get beneath the surface of this one. Economics correspondent Irving R. Levine has more.
The Helionetics Company, involved in laser technology, a key ingredient in President Reagan's proposal for a Star Wars missile defense. The company has given or offered stock to persons in a position to influence the president.
We attract the best people we can by whatever means we can.
The Helionetics Board of Directors includes Robert Gray, Deputy Director of the 1980 Reagan campaign, a close friend of the president. Admiral Thomas Hayward, recently retired as Chief of Naval Operations. William Simon, former Treasury Secretary on White House advisory groups, has agreed to join the board. And scientist Edward Teller on the White House Science Council, who urged the president to call for a laser missile defense. Teller, at a congressional hearing on laser defenses today, denied that the $800,000 in Helionetic stock he owns could have influenced his advice to the president because...
That company is working on none of the lasers which I mentioned today.
In the week prior to the president's missile speech, Helionetic stock rose from $13.50 a share to $17.50. Today it hit a new high of $23.50. The White House says it is looking into the matter to make sure that no one leaked the president's speech beforehand or gave the president advice based on personal profit. Irving R. Levine, NBC News, Washington.
The Buick Skyhawk. It lives up to its name. Hawks are known for power, for precise control, for a form that conquers the air with ease. Skyhawk. It shares something else with other Hawks. A spirit of freedom, unsurpassed by any other car anywhere. The Buick Skyhawk, with electronic fuel-injected power, front-wheel drive. And now, get 9.9 annual percentage rate financing on any new Skyhawk at your participating Buick dealer.
Until new Genie Trac-Drive, most do-it-yourself garage door openers were driven by a greasy chain. Trac-Drive replaces old-fashioned chains with a super-tough track that never needs grease or adjusting. Only Genie has it. Trac-Drive goes together faster and simpler. Protect your family and open your door the easy way.
Honey, you did it!
Trac-Drive. Only Genie has it.
Genie welcomes the ones you love home. What's behind the perfect disguise? Seeley, really? Where did he get the snap that he has? Seeley, really?
What's behind that Seeley Posturepedic feeling? Layers of luxurious comfort and a unique back support system designed in cooperation with orthopedic surgeons. So you wake up feeling really.
Their energy's revealing that Seeley Posturepedic feeling. Seeley.
gas. But now there's a unique chemical formula. Rescue Emergency Fuel. Non-explosive, not a gas, not an alcohol. Safe to store in your trunk, safe for your engine. Just pour Rescue in your tank. One bottle takes you 2 to 7 miles till you get to the nearest gas station. Get Rescue Emergency Fuel and never be afraid of running out of gas again.
San Francisco Bay is one of the world's great natural harbors. It is also one of the world's great natural collecting basins for the water and the silt that flows out of the rivers in the Central Valley of California. This winter, there have been major storms in those parts. More water, more silt. It has to go somewhere. Thursday, the U.S. Navy found that more than expected and more than the charts indicated lay in the channel off the Alameda Naval Air Station, which would be of only passing interest were it not for the fact that the Navy proposed to float the aircraft carrier Enterprise through those very same channels. It is a well-known law of physics that two objects cannot occupy the same space at the same time. For proof, this report from KRON San Francisco's 6 o'clock news.
The ship was free, finally, at about 3:30 this afternoon. We shot some tape of that as it happened. It was a combination of the high tides and the half a dozen or so tugboats that were used to push the boat free from the sandbar. Here you see the reunions. This was shot just within the last half an hour. Families who hadn't seen their husbands and wives who haven't seen their husbands and husbands who haven't seen their newborn babies finally got together now, and you can tell there's going to be some pretty sweet reunions going on tonight. On board the ship was our own Mike Saray, and I understand, Mike, that you were in a pretty hairy situation there for a while.
Well, I think I was in one of those ironic situations, Linda, because I was on deck having coffee with the Admiral, and just as he was explaining to me how uneventful and how smooth the whole 8-month tour had gone, we ran aground, and I saw the coffee in his cup go to the left. And when you're on a ship that's about 10 football fields long and it starts listing to port, that's about as comforting as being in the Bank of America and start leaning a little bit to the left. It's a very eerie feeling. And the last thing the crew of the Enterprise needed after 8 months at sea was another 5.5-hour delay before they met their loved ones. And after 61,000 miles at sea over three oceans, the last place the Enterprise expected to run into trouble was in her home waters of San Francisco Bay. She came in on a low tide around 8:30, which is customary, so that her 14-story height could clear the Oakland Bay Bridge. But at the same time, she ran into a rain squall and managed to drift south of the channel leading into Alameda. At first, we felt a little bit of a listing to port, then suddenly it shuddered to a stop. The first order was for the crew to move from the port side to the starboard side, all 5,000 of them. And then Ted Tugs went to work, and we sat there for 5.5 hours as the crew joked about turning it into a parking lot or to a national monument. But after the use of 10 tugs, 8 nuclear reactors aboard, and 5,000 very anxious sailors trying to get that ship in, she finally broke free.
Imagine you are a child, if you are not. A great big aircraft carrier goes to sea for 8 months, then drives into a sandbar. Another piece of evidence that grown-ups, given the chance, will mess it up every time. Well, then, is the answer to ask a child. If a little child shall lead us, is it okay to ask where? For questionable reasons, the Congress has done just that. And I suspect those who find the answers most interesting are those who subscribe to the philosophy that the state of innocence contains the germs of all future sins.
Sir, the biggest problem facing the world's children today is the threat of war. And my solution would be to have a massive exchange program between the United States and Russia so that we would be able to get to know these people better, because that's the only way that we're going to stop this war. I mean, we cannot go and get these people together and say, okay, we'll reduce our arms if you reduce your arms. That doesn't work.
So we've already got enough bombs to blow up the world more than once. And what do you use bombs for but violence? And if you want a peaceful world, then why do you make bombs so you can kill other people? And if you kill everybody, then there's not going to be anybody left. So if we want a peaceful world, why don't we maybe put all the bombs in an empty attic and lock the door?
I think the worst problem is child abuse, because it's the root of other problems like street gangs, crime, because they have nowhere else to turn, so they go into the streets. And my solution would be to have shelters where children can go for counsel and parents, because the parents are the ones that really need the help.
I'd like to live for a long, long time,
that I might see the world open wide, full of advantages for every child to enjoy. These are so many problems, not so many facing us, but facing other children. Hunger, war, poverty, prejudice, divorce, pollution, drugs, poor health care, child abuse, and poor education. These problems didn't start today. They won't go away tomorrow. I feel sad for children everywhere, but there is hope. It won't hurt to say, I'll help a child today. I'd like to live for a long, long time, that I might see the world open wide, full of advantages for every child to enjoy.
When the world runs in reverse and closes in, powered by the force of the state, even the strongest of adults can break and become childlike. It proves maybe that even the strongest can be ground down. Amongst the handful of dissidents resisting state power in the Soviet Union, a leader was physicist Alexander Sakharov. Despite his troubles, he maintained an inflexibility of soul in the defense of the right to speak out. Thursday, signs that he may have reached the limit of his inner resources. John Simpson of the BBC reports.
The Kremlin may be reluctant to lose one of its best scientific brains. Sakharov's often been called the father of the Soviet H-bomb, but that's more than made up for by its willingness to silence the last major figure in the Soviet dissident movement who's not in jail. Sakharov has always rejected such an idea in the past. When I saw him in his Moscow flat some years ago, for instance, he said he'd only leave the Soviet Union on the strict understanding that he'd be allowed to return. And because he didn't trust the authorities, he never accepted any of the countless offers he had to visit the West. He took his position as moral and intellectual leader of the dissident movement very seriously. He used to turn up at all the trials of dissidents, like this one of Alexander Ginzburg in 1978. And he was a kind of one-man clearinghouse for information about anyone throughout the Soviet Union who fell foul of the authorities for conscientious reasons. Because he was free to talk to Western journalists, he could publicize such cases. But in 1980, the authorities acted decisively. Sakharov had to leave his comfortable Moscow flat and was exiled to the town of Gorky, where Westerners can't go. His message to the outside world had to be passed by his wife, Yelena, acting as a go-between. Today, the International Sakharov Committee in Copenhagen is predicting that Sakharov will now agree to leave very soon. One member told me Sakharov was losing his interest in living. Sakharov now lives in an uncomfortable small flat, number 3 Gagarin Street in Gorky. The KGB uses some electronic method of stopping him using a radio or a television set in the flat, so he has to go out into the street with a transistor to hear the news. They regularly break into the flat to search it. Sakharov will be 62 next month, and he has a history of heart disease. In recent weeks, I'm told that he's given up shaving or dressing himself properly, and the isolation and occasional rough treatment he's subjected to seems to have sapped his resistance. It looks very much as though the authorities have chosen their moment well, and that at long last, Sakharov will take up the offer of an exit visa and leave the country for good.
There is something about an expert. Maybe it's that an expert doesn't always think. Why should he? He's an expert. Human nature being what it is, there is glee to be had when experts stumble, especially if they do it publicly. Take the case of the Hitler diaries, if indeed they are. The expert said they were, the expert said they weren't. My expert can beat up your expert. You pays your money, you takes your chance. While the experts squabble, we have here an equal time reply, if you will. The diaries, you will recall, were said by the West German magazine Stern to have been remnants of a plane crash in East Germany. From correspondent Jim Bitterman, the populist investigations of the case of the Hitler diaries.
In the East German village where Hitler's diaries reportedly were pulled from the wreck of a transport plane, few people had even heard about them. But ask villagers about the plane that crashed here in April 1945, and everyone has something to say. In a corner of the neatly kept village cemetery are the simply marked graves of the pilot of the plane, the crew, and Hitler's personal valet, who reports say was accompanying the Nazi dictator's personal effects from Berlin to his mountain retreat in southern Germany. Oh. But a key figure in the Stern story, Richard Elba, who saw the plane come in low over the trees and crash in a ball of flames, disagrees with the magazine's account. Nothing, he says, could have survived the fire. The plane burned for hours. At the local grocery, though, the lady behind the counter contradicts Elba. Gertrude Gerbold remembers talk of two luggage cases that were pulled from the wreckage. She never saw them, never found out what might have been in them, and thinks perhaps Russian troops carried them away when they won control over this part of Germany just 2 weeks after the plane crash. But the most intriguing suggestion comes from Halfrey Luteretz. He was just a child back then, but he believes, perhaps because his father does too, that not only were Hitler's diaries aboard the plane, but Hitler himself, along with his mistress Eva Braun. Luteretz backs up his surprising idea at the village cemetery. Buried with the crash victims, he points out, are the bodies of an unidentified soldier and an unidentified woman. No one offers explanations of who they might be or what they were doing on board the ill-fated plane. But the questions don't stop there. The East German government responded with unprecedented speed to NBC's request to visit here. And unlike any time in the past, we were not required to draw up a written proposal and were permitted to talk with anyone we wanted, anywhere we wanted, and all without an official guide. At least as curious as the villagers' conflicting stories is why East Germany wanted to have them told. Jim Bitterman, NBC News, Berndorf, East Germany.
Many of the pages of the purported diary were emblazoned with the swastika, the Nazi Party symbol. But the Nazis are not the only users of the swastika. It is an ancient symbol, appears in Sanskrit. It means he is well. And in Zuni Indian pictures, it stands for good luck and harmony. The Zunis lived in what is now New Mexico, and that accounts for the fact that since 1907, the swastika has been on the cover of the yearbook of the State University in New Mexico. The book itself is called The Swastika. A Jewish student group this year asked for a change in that, saying swastikas are a symbol of slaughter. The Student Senate declined to go along, and the regents will review all of this next month. And if they do their homework properly, they will find there are two kinds of swastikas, the Nazi one, which points right, and the other, the good one, that points left. No word about which way the one on the yearbook is pointing. That's not all we learned on Thursday. Here's some more on a reel.
To call it training the Amtrak way would be a cheap shot, were it not for the number of accidents, delays, and other snafus that seem to have plagued Amtrak. This time it was four cars that jumped the tracks in Connecticut. The cause of the derailment remains unexplained. The result was 12 injured passengers, the unluckiest of whom broke his leg.
The Israelis told Schultz they want to be reasonable. They also made it clear they want their way on guarantees of a secure border with Lebanon. Can both ideas be accommodated? With that in mind, on to Beirut and the bombed embassy, symbolic of the dangers the administration sees in the current stalemate, dangers to stability and U.S. influence in the Mideast. Then, talks with Lebanese President Gemayel to hear Lebanon's views of Israel's position and to begin reasserting the American role in putting together Mideast peace.
It is a mark of things to come or just a season of unrest. Either or both ways, France is seeing more demonstrations than it has since 68. Blocking one set of roads were the medical students who claim government reforms give government control in the classroom. Blocking other roads were farmers who think foreign imports are the reason their produce does not fetch enough. So they threw the stuff out, even that stuff which was not theirs.
The women were not invited to the memorial service for the war dead. They came anyway to protest the rape which often accompanies war. The police said they had no permit, tried to push them back. Things turned nasty. Police and protesters scuffled. The women said they were sure even the honored heroes included rapists, and they were determined to make that point.
So you want to rule the world? Solve this one. The ship in Buenos Aires is taking on supplies before taking on 200 Argentines whose kin were killed in the Falklands War. It is to sail in 2 days. But Great Britain has said it may not come to the Falklands unless it is under sponsorship of the Red Cross. The Red Cross has declined. The Argentines don't say how they intend to land. The British don't say how they intend to stop them.
They're the talk of the town. The used cars from the gallant men of olds. Talk about selection.
The gallant men of olds, in general, had a wide selection of cars. used cars.
Talk about quality.
It's a car that was very well taken care of, and it's a car that I always dreamt of owning.
They really didn't look like a used car. They looked really new.
See the talk of the town used cars. Talk to your Gallant Men of Olds. You'll love what you hear.
Shootan Camera, 312 West Randolph, presents the exciting Canon AE-1 program. It has all the features of the famous Canon AE-1, plus it automatically adjusts exposure and shutter speed. The Canon AE-1 program is Shootan priced for a low $219.95.
Shoot with the best, your cost is less. Get Shootan,
Shootan
for every camera need.
Shootan Camera, downtown on Randolph between Wacker and Franklin.
I read, and you can read, the true story of one of the biggest money-spending sprees ever, but only if you buy this week's People. Because only People has this story of the family whose marriage into Saudi royalty led from rags to riches to disaster. No wonder so many people trust People. Then Sandy Duncan, Cleo Goldsmith, and others combined showbiz and childcare, how commercials helped develop Mariette Hartley's career, Matt Dillon's teenage co-star, and plenty more. So pick up this week's People for yourself, for your family, to read about a royal spending spree.
When people talk about sports cars, they nearly always compare them to this one, the legend, Datsun's 280ZX. Let's face it, there's no comparison. This turbocharged rocket blows the doors off Toyota Supra, even Porsche's 944. If you want awesome power at a price that won't blow you away, then this is it. The awesome 280ZX. It's priced and powered to go. Take a test lap at your All-American Metro Datsun dealers. They're driven to save you money.
He broke into the Queen's bedchamber. He was taken away. He got his name and his picture in the papers and his 15 minutes of fame. And apparently he developed a taste for it. Look out, prime time. Here I come. Of such are legends born. Not this time. Not ready for prime time and not likely to be. He should have stuck with an audience of one.
Michael Fagan, break-in artist of the royal residence, launches a singing career. His life veers from palace to punk.
Outside the plane, the empire machine. I made me a shadow.
This was rehearsal of Punk's version of God Save the Queen in preparation for his launch last night. All mildly daring, for his public appearances so far have been limited to the backs of police vans. He climbed into the Queen's bedroom last summer, did 3 months in a mental home as a result. But Britain is forgiving of eccentrics, and Fagan claims Punk is one way of saying sorry.
I feel very, very sorry about it. How sorry could a man be that he's interrupted the Queen's lifestyle and upset the royalty in that way? So I can say I'm sorry, but I don't feel it's been enough to say that I'm sorry. So this is my way, in my own way. It might not be very good, but it's my way of saying apology, you know.
At any event, things did not go all right on the night. Hundreds of punkers poured into the fathomless gloom of the Batcave Disco. They were anxious to see him, but it wasn't clear if he was anxious to see them. In the end, his performance was as haphazard as his palace break-in.
Don't take the plane! The blazing sun was shining!
Fagan hopes to cash in on his notoriety, reminding people that this is the apparition the Queen saw by her bed. Her Majesty's experience could have been worse, however. She was spared his singing.
A screaming light machine.
Brian Stewart, CBC News, London.
With today's technology, almost anything is possible. Things that make life better, like the Buick Century. With its advanced electronics, front-wheel drive, and computer design, even its standard engine is electronically fuel-injected. Happily, there's one thing technology will never replace.
May I be of further assistance?
No. This I like to do all by myself.
The sheer pleasure of driving a Buick. The 1983 Buick Century.
Why do you insist on Preparation H?
I'd never buy any kind of product out on the market that would not shrink hemorrhoidal tissues. And if I suffer, then Preparation H is going to be right by my side.
Doctor recommended. Preparation H often gives temporary relief from pain and itch flare-ups, even helps shrink swelling of inflamed hemorrhoidal tissues.
Why should I buy anything that doesn't shrink hemorrhoidal tissues? I trust Preparation H 100%.
Preparation H relieves pain and itch, even helps shrink swelling.
Oh, Ed, I think we need a bigger price. I better rent the truck.
It's easy to move yourself with a Jartran truck or trailer. Jartran vans even have automatic transmission and power steering.
Ed, don't forget the chair.
Right now, along with a low price, you get unlimited mileage on one-way moves.
Ed, dear, we're here. Ed. Oh, heaven. I must have forgotten.
Jartran, for long moves or short hops.
This is the last week to prepare for V, the most extraordinary miniseries ever made. A daring TV journalist struggling to uncover the startling truth behind the aliens' visit to Earth. And a beautiful and brave young scientist fighting for the very survival of the human race. Together, they take you on a fantastic journey to meet the visitors. Prepare yourself for a television event that's out of this world. Prepare for V Sunday.
Carl Yastrzemski, the 43-year-old captain of the Boston Red Sox, came down with back spasms Tuesday during batting practice in Seattle. "Feels like the same thing that happens to me every year," said Yaz. But he's back at the University of Massachusetts Medical Center in traction, and there's no predicting when the doctors will let him play again. Depends on the weather, they say. His back acts up when it's cold. And the Milwaukee Brewers put southpaw Jerry Augustine on the disabled list for 21 days. We saw him last night taking Carlton Fisk's line drive on the forearm. The Brewer doctors are still not sure whether his arm was fractured or not. More tests Monday. Otherwise, not much action in sports Thursday, even if you count cancellations. Here are the scores on a very short roll. Rick Middleton to Brad Palmer for a breakaway Bruin goal as Boston evens the series with the Islanders 1-1. Barry Pettersson scored twice and tied Phil Esposito's club record, 13 playoff goals set in 1970. But that's not what beat the Islanders, not entirely. Here's what made the difference, Bruin goalie Pete Peters. He turned away 15 shots in the first period alone, and it was his steady goaltending and several spectacular saves that held the Islanders to a goal point. That sort of thing makes a goalie unpopular. The Islanders couldn't beat Peters with skill, so they tried to beat him with whatever was at hand. Game 3, Saturday night.
Don't be fooled by the notion that this is the part of the program devoted to sports. What we have here is an attempt by the producer to be tricky. What we have here is an animal story. Yes, it's about a race, barely. But it's animals we're talking about, believe me. One other note, this story is neither for the faint of heart nor ear. Norm Yule of WAVE reports from Louisville.
For the
at this race, there are plenty of familiar sounds, but this is not Churchill Downs. This is Spalding College. No horses here. It's the running of the rodents, the 11th year. Just like the Derby, there are eight of these races as trainers put their rats through strenuous paces. There are lemonade juleps. Here's King and Queen Rat. It's a copy of the Derby, and that is that. And here's the equivalent of Millionaire's Row, but the infield's too small for people to go. Each year they add more rat derby events, and a quarter bet can win you 30 cents. As my old Kentucky home in the background is played, the field of entries go on parade. Then they enter the gate for the race of the day, and the run for the Fruit Loops is now underway. Palace Princess in first is the winner, and the traditional wreath becomes her dinner. Now she will breed next year's racing giants.
The other rats will donate their lives to science.
Trainer Danny Corbett says his rat won out of fear. She saw a cat in the crowd and went into high gear. I asked how long they've been training for this.
Since they were weaned.
The rats, that is. The math science chairman says it's more than recreation. It gives the students a good science education.
It also goes along with the students' preparation to enter the real rat race after graduation.
Now it's back to class for the rat racing crews. In Louisville, Norm Yule for NBC News.
Fleetwood Construction Company is family-owned and operated. No high-priced salesmen. So we don't cut quality, we cut prices. Like kitchen remodeling from $25.85 a month, roofing and siding from $29.54 a month, or remodel your bathroom for as little as $18.46 a month. And with our low-cost bank financing, there's no money down and no payments for 60 days. For free estimates, call now. Fleetwood Construction, 588-3232, 588-3232.
Here from Paris?
Oui, I do the designers' collections.
Clothes, Mounia.
Ah, fashion fair cosmetic.
Clothes, Mounia.
Now we can buy fashion fair right in Paris. Superb.
Here, Mounia.
And now, Fashion Fair offers this dazzling Vin Rosé beauty bonus from the French wine collection. Your gift with any Fashion Fair purchase of $8.50 or more.
Fashion Fair.
Fashion Fair is available at Carson Peary Scott & Company.
Your better Buick dealers are about to make those front-wheel drive imports take a back seat with three front-wheel drive Buicks at a price under $7,000. For sporty car lovers, there's Buick's racy Skyhawk. For economy and comfort, there's the roomy Buick Skylark. And for sleek luxury, there's Buick's little limousine, Century. Now you can enter the world of front-wheel drive for as little as $69.58 at your Chicagoland, Northern Indiana better Buick dealer.
You look bad this morning, Harry.
Oh, the kid's screaming for an Atari. The TV broke last night, and June's going to leave home if we don't get central air conditioning.
York, Harry.
York to you too, Fred.
No, Harry. Energy-saving York central air conditioners. And your York dealer has gifts like Atari or Sharp TV plus cash rebates if you buy before May 31st.
Hooray for York. I'm going to call my York dealer and then tell June to start unpacking.
In Waukegan, call Del Mar Heating, Lombard Rainbow Heating, Lamont Pearson Heating.
It has become almost commonplace, and Thursday it happened again, this time to the French. I speak of being caught snooping. Three of their correspondents in Moscow accused of what was politely called covert activities. And just as politely, the French denied it and left Moscow. One for the Soviets. In the other column, perhaps, the Norwegian Navy was looking Friday for what it said was a foreign sub lurking submerged off of its coast. Norway did not accuse the Soviets, but the search is going on about 500 miles from where the Swedes said six Soviet submarines spied on their Navy last fall. It has been a busy season for all of this, and none have been more busy, if Western governments are to be believed, than the Russians, who, as one would expect, take a different view of things. To sort this out, correspondent Richard Valeriani.
It was the biggest spy case in years. 47 Soviet citizens, diplomats, journalists, and others expelled from France earlier this month, all described as agents of the secret services of the Soviet Union, all accused of espionage. While the size of the group deported from France was unusual, the act of expelling Soviets from Western countries is not. Since January, Soviet citizens accused of spying have been arrested in or expelled from Switzerland, West Germany, Great Britain, Italy, the Netherlands, Denmark, Spain, France, and outside of Europe, Australia, and the United States. A total of 66 so far this year, compared to 49 during all of last year. Not surprisingly, the accused denied the charges.
Have you done any spying for your government?
Absolutely not.
Have you done any spying for anybody else?
Absolutely not.
It was just, the worldwide campaign now against the USSR. And to my mind, Australia tried to join that movement.
But FBI Director William Webster recently denied there was any worldwide orchestration of expulsions.
These are going on all the time, in lesser or varying or increasing degrees in different countries. It's just the capacity of the country or the intelligence agencies to make a particular activity public that seems to have coincided in what you've seen the last few weeks.
The Soviet embassy in Washington and other diplomatic missions elsewhere provide the cover for most of the Soviet spies. The FBI estimates that about one-third of the 3,000 to 4,000 Eastern Bloc diplomats assigned to this country are engaged in some kind of spying. Less and less of it deals with classic military secrets.
The area that we see a heavier concentration of effort in is in high technology, particularly laser technology, computer technology, micro technology, and the production systems that go with the technology itself.
Most sophisticated Western technology with even marginal military potential is embargoed for shipment to communist countries under a formal agreement among the industrial democracies. The Soviets, who are far back in high tech, put as much effort into stealing it as developing it, a theme which Defense Secretary Weinberger has constantly sounded in a variety of forums.
Where they failed to get what they wanted openly, and that wasn't very often, they resorted to a well-coordinated illegal acquisition program. They use agents and co-opt various citizens and take advantage of unsuspecting businessmen and to take advantage of the great desire for more and more trade. And they've moved goods through neutral and third world countries, and they're by this means gaining access to Western technology on an unprecedented and an alarming scale.
If, as FBI Chief Webster says, there is no coordinated Western plan for cracking down on Soviet spies, why are more of them getting caught? Ronald Reagan and Yuri Andropov personify two of the most widely held explanations. White House officials claim that the Reagan administration has sensitized America's allies to the problem of Soviet industrial thievery by harping on it at economic summit meetings and elsewhere, and the expulsions have been one result. Some analysts speculate that with Andropov, the former head of the KGB, the Soviet Secret Service, now in charge in the Kremlin, Soviet operatives are on a looser rein and are pushing beyond established spies-will-be-spies limits tolerated by intelligence agencies. One longtime analyst of Soviet affairs here at the State Department summed up the situation this way. The KGB, he said, is just having a bad spring. Richard Valeriani, NBC News, Washington.
High prices have turned the great European cars away from you. Now Renault brings the price of European technology down to earth. Presenting Renault Alliance, front-wheel drive with fully independent suspension that forces the wheels to hug the road. Renault Alliance, European technology built in America. $56.95. Low financing now available on Renault Alliance.
Mmm, get happy. Mmm, get happy.
Now they're getting happy. New Happy Cat from Purina. The new moist and meaty tasting cat food. Happy Cat stays fresh and meaty tasting in the bowl so cats can come back for more all day.
Mmm, get happy.
New Happy Cat cat food. Its delicious meaty taste makes cats happy all day.
This is the last week to prepare for V, the most extraordinary miniseries ever made. A daring TV journalist struggling to uncover the startling truth behind the aliens' visit to Earth. And a beautiful and brave young scientist fighting for the very survival of the human race. Together, they take you on a fantastic journey to meet the visitors. Prepare yourself for a television event that's out of this world. Prepare for V Sunday.
Saturday on Monitor. 3 years ago, Fidel Castro sent the U.S. a present. 40,000 criminals disguised as refugees.
I've never met a more violent group of people.
Now they are raping, robbing, and murdering in our cities.
Other murderers are afraid of them.
Why are they still here? And if American industry is fighting to keep up with Japan's, why are we paying for their military defense?
Spider-Man!
Don't miss Monitor. Saturday at 10, 9 Central and Mountain on NBC.
There are few among us who have not, at one time or another, opened a package to find the cookies did not survive the U.S. mail. There is no truth to the rumor the post office has a special room for stomping on packages. It does, however, have a special room where packages too wounded to carry on are rewrapped. The rewrapping room, it is called. And from the rewrapping room, a story to remind us all that justice is all we are promised. Justice, not mercy. Joan Gartland of WMAR in Baltimore reports.
During their trial last March, Baltimore Post Office employees William Ferguson and Norman Wilson were shown on a government videotape opening damaged mail and eating some of the contents. According to testimony in the trial, the two passed up some valuable items like coins, but took and consumed some candy bars planted by postal inspectors and several helpings of chocolate chip cookies a Baltimore woman was sending to her son at college in Pennsylvania. Ferguson and Wilson, both longtime postal employees, were charged with destruction of the U.S. mail, a misdemeanor. They were tried by a jury here in U.S. District Court in Baltimore last month and convicted. Today, federal magistrate Daniel Klein placed the two on a year's probation and required each of them to perform 100 hours of community service. The magistrate cited the fact that Ferguson, who is 44, and Wilson, 59, have no criminal record and that they have already suffered suspension from their jobs and public ridicule. Although the so-called cookie case has been treated with humor in the news media, Klein said the men still committed a serious offense. Government prosecutor Glenda Gordon agreed, saying the privacy of the mail must be ensured, and if it had been police officers rather than postal workers searching and seizing the mail, the public would be outraged.
The camera doesn't lie, and all have received their due, and others, once again, will begin receiving their treats. It is likewise pictures, treats, and large operations that this next story concerns, and a situation in which rain and storm did indeed stop the couriers from the completion of their contractually guaranteed rounds. Emil Guillermo of KRON reports from Pacifica, California.
40,000 Pacificans see it as a fringe benefit. If you take cable channel 8, you get all the other TV channels. That's the problem. February 28th, a stormy night knocked out power in Pacifica. That included CBS's showing of the final episode of MASH. So now channel 8 has asked CBS to let it reshow the two-hour episode. CBS has refused.
They feel that if we broadcast it in Pacifica, that the Pacificans who would normally be watching CBS programming would be watching MASH on our local access station.
Channel 8 has come a long way from their old black and white days, about a year ago, thanks to a few sponsors. Channel 8 depends a lot on volunteers who get to work off local traffic tickets here.
Well, we can't let people come here that have any morals convictions.
Its purpose is to serve the town, so the top-rated show is the Pacifica City Council.
I'm going to be out of town from Tuesday through Sunday, so if nobody answers the phone, that's what they'll be.
But now it wants MASH as a public service. It started a petition drive and hopes to send 3,000 signatures to CBS.
I guess it's David versus Goliath.
Well, Channel 8 does have it easier than David. Goliath had two eyes. Emil Guillermo reporting from Pacifica, California for NBC News.
Presenting the ABCs of saving money. A is for AMC Spirits and four-wheel drive SX4s. Save an instant $1,000. A is for AMC Concords and four-wheel drive Eagles. Save an instant $1,500. J is for Jeep. Get a free soft top with any CJ or Scrambler. R is for Renault. An instant $800 off list on LeCar and instant $1,000 off 18i's. R is for Renault Alliance at $56.95 and Renault Turbo Fuego with 9.9% annual percentage rate financing available. Save money now at your AMC Jeep Renault dealers while it's as easy as ABC.
I read, and you can read, the true story of one of the biggest money-spending sprees ever, but only if you buy this week's People. Because only People has this story of the family whose marriage into Saudi royalty led from rags to riches to disaster. No wonder so many people trust People. Then Sandy Duncan, Cleo Goldsmith, and others combined showbiz and childcare, how commercials helped develop Mariette Hartley's career, Matt Dillon's teenage co-star, and plenty more. So pick up this week's People for yourself, for your family, to read about a royal spending spree.
Since 1650, Henninger beer has been brewed in Frankfurt, Germany. For over 300 years, nothing but the finest natural ingredients have gone into Henninger, preserved only by its brown bottle, so you may enjoy this award-winning beer at its best. One taste of delicious Henninger beer, and you'll know why. Henninger is truly the classic of imported beers. you may never settle for a green bottle again.
Henninger beer. Henninger beer. Henninger beer.
Your better Buick dealers are about to make those front-wheel drive imports take a back seat with three front-wheel drive Buicks and a price under $7,000. For sporty car lovers, there's Buick's racy Skyhawk. For economy and comfort, there's the roomy Buick Skylark. And for sleek luxury, there's Buick's little limousine, Century. Now you can enter the world of front-wheel drive for as little as $69.58 at your Chicagoland, Northern Indiana better Buick dealer.
Here are the headlines. In El Salvador, the government was pleased with the president's tough talk about its problems. It was less pleased by President Reagan's selection of former Congressman Richard Stone as his special envoy to that country. It was hoping for someone with more prestige and expertise. Many of the president's advisors on the use of lasers in space own stock in a company that makes lasers. They owned the stock before the talk on space lasers, and it has increased substantially in value. The aide said the company makes other kinds of lasers. The White House is looking into it. The aircraft carrier Enterprise, one of the Navy's biggest ships, ran aground on a sandbar in San Francisco Bay Thursday. A civilian pilot was at the helm, red faces all around. High tide freed the vessel.
And these items, as it had promised it would do, the government of Argentina gave a formal accounting Thursday for its war against leftists during the 70s and how and why it was that thousands of people in Argentina disappeared. The government said that was legal, and besides, it had been necessary. This is from the if at first you don't succeed, give up skydiving department. The Pershing 2, the little missile that too often couldn't again on Thursday. This time the test launch was canceled because of a problem in the guidance system, which is how you aim the thing. At the White House on Thursday, atomic scientist Dr. Seth Nedermeyer was given by the president an award for breakthroughs in atomic discoveries. He deserved an award for the best acceptance speech I have ever heard. When he was given the award, Dr. Nedermeyer said, there must be some mistake. And finally, from the United Press Wire, a story that tells you everything you need to know in one sentence, but not until the sentence is finished. Here it is. A new study, proving the cynics are wrong, shows most people forced off welfare rolls by Reagan administration budget cuts became self-supporting. Welfare Secretary Margaret Heckler said Thursday. And if the question is Friday's weather, the answer is rain for California, the Plateau, the Rockies, the Central Plains, the Ohio Valley, the Tennessee Valley, the Northeast. Leftovers get what they get. Cambodian soldiers killed her father. She was put into a labor camp and digging ditches at five. She and her brothers and sisters ran away to Thailand, and in 1979, she arrived in the U.S., malnourished and able to count to 10. That was all the English she had. But America loves a success story. She worked. She learned, and this week she competed in a spelling bee. The president heard about 12-year-old Lin Yan. He called her just before the match on Thursday night, wished her luck, told her she was a fine example of America. The little Cambodian girl spelled adornment, quadrant, scentless, exhilarate, and rambunctious. And then she came face to face with the fact that there is no such thing as fair, not ever.
Number 30. Your word is enchilada. Do you know that word?
No.
Enchilada. Enchilada.
E-N-C-H-E-L-L-A-T-A.
I'm sorry.
If enchiladas are not yet one of the ingredients in the melting pot, it does not mean the process of accommodation to a new land is any less vigorous and no less varied than earlier. This century has seen immigrants from Eastern Europe, the Far East, the Caribbean, trace many of the same steps, one after the other. It may be familiar, it remains remarkable. NBC's Charles McLean reports from Miami.
3 years ago, they were refugees. 125,000 Cubans boat-lifted to Florida in what was then called the Freedom Flotilla.
You came in May. You came in the boats or the plane?
Both.
Children of the boat lift, like Mario Armoran, struggled to learn a new language.
Does she have a pencil?
She has.
She has a pencil.
I have
have a pencil.
I have a pencil.
Today, these new immigrants are becoming a part of the American mainstream. We spoke with a dozen students at Hialeah Junior High School in Miami. They came here 3 years ago anticipating a better life in the United States, and most feel they've found it.
I think it's a very good place to live. I like it.
Cuba, not everybody can wear, you know, a pair of shoes daily, you know. You know, they have one pair a year, you know, a pair of shoes a year. And here you can go to a store and buy 1,000 pairs if you got the money.
In the country, you have to ask for the food. But here you can take it and go to the cashier. It's different. I like it. I like it. And you can eat everything, fruits. Cuba, we don't have fruits, just banana.
Although they're only in their early teens, most of these students have an idea of what they'd like to do with their lives.
I would like to be a teacher.
I want to be a singer.
I think I'll go into the computer business. That's the future.
I would like to be an artist.
These children of the boat lift are becoming young adults, Americans now, with something they never had in Cuba, hope for the future.
This country has many opportunities to offer to all of us. We just, 3 years ago, I didn't know anything about this.
It's a whole new thing. Language, customs, other friends, a whole new system including school, a whole new way of seeing life, you know? Like, it's different. You can really think about the future here, what I want to be, what I really want to be.
Charles McLean, NBC News, Miami.
What most people really don't want to be is old and poor. Many people don't have much to say about that, but some at least think they do, and they are the resourceful ones, in the eyes of some, too resourceful. In that category put the nine folks who showed up in a courtroom in Dedham, Massachusetts. The oldest was 68, just out of a coma. The youngest, 58, all arrested, tried, convicted for moonlighting as bookies. Seven of them were retired, existing on pensions of no more than $450 a month. All of them had no prior record, and all supplemented their incomes working for a 70-year-old bookmaker. The judge fined each $1,000. Walked down a flight of steps to sentence a woman who was too feeble to get to the courtroom. Nice. Likewise nice, the tax people in Illinois who have demanded that William Land pay sales tax on the food he serves in his restaurant, where the food is free. The restaurant operated entirely on donations, mostly from William Land, $1,700 a month. Bill Land began it 3 months ago when a woman came to him with nothing to feed her kids but cooked potato peelings. He fed her, decided to feed others. Said to himself it's time folks did more for each other than sit in church and read the word, Bill Land decided to be a doer of the word until he ran into the tax people. But he persevered and prevailed, even though, as he said, you're not going to believe this, but it's hard in the state of Illinois to give away food. I believe it. It was a fact well put several hundred years back, before Illinois taxers or Massachusetts judges, by William Danby, who said, men have died of the festering of a gnat bite. And so it goes.
I don't know why you're bothered by that. There is a word to explain it. Enchilada. And good night.
On Monitor, 3 years ago, Castro gave the U.S. a present. 40,000 criminals disguised as refugees.
I've never met a more violent group of people.
Now they're raping, robbing, and murdering in our cities. And if American industry is fighting to keep up with Japan's, why are we paying for their military defense? Don't miss Monitor Saturday.
Enjoy the great taste of sirloin steak from Dominick's, a barbecue favorite. Tender, delicious sirloin steak is a low $1.89 a pound at Dominick's.
If you take dope, cut it out. If you drink too much, cut it out. And if you want to live, cut it out now. Don't be a dope.
Thank you.
The new Nissan 4x4 has loads more than the competition, with the most powerful standard engine in its class. More legroom than Ford Ranger, Chevy S10, and Toyota. Tough double steel walls, plus on-demand four-wheel drive you can't get on Toyota. Want more? Then get more. The new Nissan 4x4. It's loaded.
All this and special 9.9% financing. See your all-American Metro Datsun dealers. They're driven to save you money.
It's Judgment Day on Channel 5, tomorrow at 4.